My name is Leticia. My story began when I was probably about 19, 20 years old. I had moved to Arkansas with my dad, and I met a guy, and he was my boyfriend for a while. And, you know, I ended up moving in with him and his brother and his dad and his stepmom. So the dad's girlfriend, you know, I thought she was his girlfriend the whole time, but ended up finding out that she was being pimped out by his dad. So we ended up going with them to like a trailer park. That's when she got out and she, you know, was going from one to the next, to the next, to the next and everything. And I'm just in the car, like not knowing what's going on. Like I've never even been a part of anything like that. I've never seen it. Like, and so that's when she came to the car and she was like, come with me. And my boyfriend was like, you know, it's okay, you can go with her. I can't even remember what she said that we were gonna go do, but she took me into one of the trailers and, you know, it was full of men. And she basically was like, okay, this is what we're gonna do. Like, you're gonna make some money and this is how you're gonna do it. So that's how I got started into doing the prostitution. It was all just kind of very surreal to me because, you know, like I said, like I thought this was his dad's girlfriend, you know. We had been together for maybe at least a year before all of this came to light. And so then, you know, from there on out, he wasn't, you know, abusive or anything. At first, it was just all like manipulation, like mind games and, you know, we need the money, babe, like, this is the only way we can get some money, and, you know, and so I was just like, okay. And so it just kind of became like a regular thing, and that's where he would take me. He would take me to the trailer parks, and I would just have to go from one trailer to the next, to the next, to the next, and you know, and at the time, like, you know, I was young and I thought I loved this guy and if we make enough money, we can get our own place and everything like that. But it was just very, like, it was just very degrading. And each trailer, and you know how big, like, trailer parks can be. And it's like, I had to go in each one and it's like each trailer had like five or six guys in each one. And it was just like, didn't feel good. And then just the more I did it, it just, you know, I ended up becoming numb to it. Then eventually I got into stripping and he would take me, drop me off at the club, and then he would pick me up. And the whole time, like, he never was abusive, but like I said, it was like the manipulation and the head games and what our future would look like if, you know, I continue to do it and make so much money. And so that's how I got introduced to it. I think I was probably about 20 at the time. And then eventually I moved back to California and that's when I met my baby daddy. It was pretty like short after I moved back to California that I met him. So again, I love this guy, you know, everything's perfect. And, you know, I think 6 months into the relationship is when I got pregnant with my first daughter. And so then we ended up moving. We were living with his mom at the time and we ended up moving. And then after I had her, that's when everything, you know, changed. He became extremely abusive. He was sexually abusive. He was mentally, emotionally, physically, and he was selling meth at the time. And that's how I got introduced to meth, was through my baby daddy. You know, we tried it together, and that's, you know, kind of where the rest of my life went downhill. I got hooked on it. I was smoking it just to deal with, you know, he kept me from my family. He kept me from any type of like socialization. I couldn't go to church, I couldn't work. You know, any money that I was getting from like welfare, he would take that. So that was just like a vicious cycle that I could not seem to get out of. I got more and more addicted to the meth and was smoking it more and more and more. And, you know, finally decided enough is enough. Like, I gotta get me and my kid out of here, you know, and ended up leaving and going to live with my mom. And shortly after that is when I found out I was pregnant with my second daughter. So, you know, the whole time I was pregnant with her, I was just like, you know, in my head. I was clean at that time. And, you know, I just kept telling myself, like, you know, well, I don't want my kids to grow up in a broken home, you know, like, maybe he'll change. And, you know, it was just going back and forth with that idea. And after I had her, I would take them to go visit with him, and we would get high together. And it was one day that he was driving us home, and, you know, I guess he had found out I was talking to some other guy, and he wasn't happy about it. And so that's when he was just like, I know about this guy, and blah, 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 and, you know, like, if I can't have you, nobody will. And he literally, like, reached into the center console and pulled out a gun and put it to my head and pulled the trigger. And for some reason, it didn't go off. So emotional. And that's when he, like, proceeded to, like, pistol whip me and just started, like, beating me up in the front seat of the car. Well, I had my two babies in the back seat, and they're just screaming, and then they're just crying and screaming, and he ended up pulling over at one of his brother's houses, and you know, his brother came outside, and he got out the car, came around to my side, to the passenger side, and opened the door, and, you know, proceeded to beat me up in the front seat. And his brother was just standing there, like, you know, what the heck is going on? But he didn't do anything. He just grabbed one of my babies out the back seat, because she was screaming so much. And so he grabbed her out the back seat and start, you know, was holding her. And he's just continuing to beat me. And then he starts slamming the door. Then he, like, starts slamming the door on my knee. And I have knee problems to this day because of that. So then, you know, he got back in the car, and then we took off, and we went somewhere else, and he was like, I have to stop off at my, you know, his connect's house to get some more drugs. And so we stopped there, and he's like, I'm going inside, and he's like, don't move, you know, you better not move, don't come inside, or I'm gonna kill everybody in the house. So he went inside, and he's in there for a while, and I'm just thinking to myself, okay, like, how do I get away from this? You know, because on the way there, he was telling me how he's gonna kill me and the girls, and how he's gonna dump our bodies in the Sacramento River. And so I'm just thinking, like, okay, how the heck am I supposed to get away from this guy, you know? So even though he told me not to go inside, I went inside. I went inside just to see, like, where he was exactly at in the house. So he was actually upstairs in the bathroom getting high. And when I saw that, I was like, okay, this is my chance. You know, I have a little bit of time. So I went back outside to the car. I opened up the trunk. I got the stroller out. I opened up the stroller. I put my oldest in there first, and then I put the baby in with her car seat. And I just took off running down the street, banging and knocking on people's doors to let me in. Finally, somebody opened the door, and they saw, like, you know, I was beat up, and I was just a mess, and I just was screaming, and I was just like, please let me in, please let me in, like, he's gonna kill me, he's gonna kill me. So they let me inside, and I called my mom. I didn't call the police, I called my mom. So she, you know, asked where I was at, and, you know, I told her, and then she ended up coming to get me. And as she's putting us in the car, he's driving around looking for me. And that's when he sees my mom's car and he sees my mom. And so he pulls up and I can't remember exactly what he said to her, but being my mama bear that she is, was like, no, you can't, that's it. Like, you're not gonna see my daughter ever again. Like, that's it, you know? And I don't know what she said to him really, like, besides that, but he got back in his car and he left. After all of that, and then going to trial and having to testify against him and everything, he did get arrested and he did some time. I think he was sentenced to 7 years, I believe, for terrorist threats and a couple other things. And he only did, I don't even think it was a whole year. And, you know, they gave me a lifetime restraining order, my kids a restraining order, they took his parental rights from him. So after that, I think is when I kind of lost it a little bit mentally and, you know, met another guy, you know, and how that started was, you know, we went on a couple of dates and then we ended up going back to his place. You know, we were intimate and, you know, after that is when he was like, okay, this is what we're gonna do now. And he was like, that's when he introduced me to prostitution. That's the second guy. So I've had a few different pimps, but there's one that I went back to two or three times. I went back to this, the same one, because of the, like, the lies and the manipulation and how things would be better and how, like, I could get a house, I could be, you know, I could get my kids and everything. So that was kind of like the goal for me, was to get a place of my own with my kids. And so dealing with the abuse, the physical abuse, was something that I was willing to deal with because of the dream that I was sold. I don't know, it was just kind of, it's hard to explain the type of mental hold that they have on you when you're going through it. You know, it wasn't just me, it was, you know, a couple other girls that he had. There's one that he's had for a long time and has had kids with, and he has a lot of kids, but not with just her, but with several other women. And I don't know if that was like one of his ways of keeping control, was getting these girls pregnant. And, you know, for a while there, I felt like he was trying to do the same with me, and thank God it never happened. But I know that the one girl, she was there from the beginning and through the, you know, the couple different times that I went back and forth with him, she was still there. And, you know, I don't think she ever thought about even trying to get away. There was one time where I had actually called my mom and she came to the apartment, but she came to get me. And she told the other girl as well, like, you can come, like, just leave, like, come with us too, you know, you and the baby, like, just come with us. And she stayed, but my mom got me out of there. But yeah, it was kind of like a roller coaster with him. He was very, very manipulative, and he was very charming, and that's actually his pimp name, is Charm. So, but yeah, very charming, very good with his words. And, you know, when he would hit me or beat me up and stuff like that, it was like, you know, wouldn't ever see it coming, the way that it would happen. I remember one time he had sent us into the store to buy some stuff at the gas station before we got on the road. And I came out and I had a Black and Mild that I had bought for myself, and got in the front seat And he was like, who told you to buy that? And I was like, well, you know, because it's money, you know. And I was like, well, I thought I could buy myself a black amount, you know. And like before I even knew it, he like backhanded me with his fist closed and broke my nose. And that was it. And proceeded to get on the road and take us to wherever he was taking us to. And so like little incidents like that, he would be really like cool for a minute and, you know, very charming, like I said. And then something else would happen. And it was over like the smallest little things. And I think another time was I bought a pack of cigarettes and it was like that, you know, like a switch went off with him. And that was my whole cycle with that. There was another guy that I ended up prostituting for. And it was the same thing with him. When I met him, we went on a few dates, thought I was dating this guy, and turned out to be the same thing. And then, you know, we're driving down Stockton Boulevard, and all of a sudden he's like, okay, bitch, get out of the car. Like, go make me some money. And that's how that started with him. So every time that I've gotten involved with a pimp, is that's how it's always started with me, is, you know, we go on a few dates and then we end up having sex, and then it's like now they have like this control, and it's like, oh yeah, by the way, I'm a pimp, like go make me some money, if not this is what's gonna happen, I'm gonna hurt your family, I'm gonna beat your ass. And with that guy, it wasn't very long before I left that situation, but you know, he picks me up on Stockton Boulevard, you know, asks me, you know, how much did I make, and you know, apparently it wasn't enough, so that made him angry. And we're on the freeway, and he pulls over on the side of the freeway in the middle of the night, gets out of the car, comes around to my side, and drags me out of the car and starts beating my ass on the side of the freeway. And then he proceeds to start kicking me, stomping me out, starts kicking me in my head, and I'm trying to block my head as much as I can, and he's just kicking me and kicking me and kicking me, and, you know, screaming, I'll kill you, bitch, I'll kill you, bitch. Like, you know, what do you think this is? Is this a game to you? Like, you know, I told you to go out there and make me some money, like, what is this? And so, next thing I know, like, I'm waking up in his bed the next morning, so I guess he kicked me unconscious, and, you know, woke up in his bed the next day and asked him to take me to my best friend's house to get some stuff or whatever. And when I went inside, that's when her and her dad and everybody in the house had saw, like, my face and everything, and they were like, you know, and her dad went outside and basically told him to leave or he was gonna call the cops, and that's how that ended. I do know not too long after that, he was arrested for pretty much the same thing, but with an underage girl. I believe she was like 14. He had kidnapped her, did the same thing. He left her, he actually left her on the side of the freeway for dead. And, you know, she was found, and he was eventually caught and arrested. So yeah, so like going through all of these things in my life, you know, just led me into my addiction with meth, and it just got worse and worse. Eventually, that's all that I really cared about was getting high, and you know, eventually I ended up homeless. My mom kicked me out and ended up homeless on the streets of Rancho Cordova for 3 years. When I like got out of the lifestyle and everything, it was just like I would look back at it all and like the amount of money that I've made through all of that, it's like, what was it all for? Because I don't have a dime to my name to this day. Like, I don't have anything to show for it besides these like injuries that I have to deal with. You know, I have back issues, I have knee problems, I used to get migraines all the time because of the head trauma. Like, I have all these things that I have to deal with emotionally and physically, and it's just like, what was it all for? Like, what was the point of all of it, you know? I was one of the lucky ones, because I would hear stories from other girls and stuff that they would deal with from a trick, and like being robbed, being beat up, being raped, you know, stabbed, like, you know, just crazy stuff that they would do. And I never once encountered anything like that from a trick. I don't know if it was just God looking out for me or what, but like, you know, and some of the girls that I would go out with, you know, stuff would happen to them. Find somebody in the room, you know, because we would share rooms and stuff. You know, and it was just one time where, like, I found one of the girls in the room, and she was beat up pretty bad, and, you know, all her money was taken and everything. And never once would there be, like, sympathy or, like, protection from our pimp, which that's what they're supposed to be there for, I guess. That's part of the reason why they say that we need them, is for our protection. But at the same time, when stuff would happen to one of the girls, there was no protection there. It would be all on her. And then she would get even more backlash because she let it happen.
Did you ever work outside of Sacramento County?
Yes.
Where else did you go?
Detroit, Memphis, Los Angeles was a big one, Oklahoma, Arkansas, I think we went to Colorado once, Bakersfield, Nevada, Santa Clara, Santa Maria, all Southern California area. We drove everywhere.
So like if an officer was to contact you outside of a sting operation, mm-hmm. if you were out working and they were to come up and be like, hey, how are you? Is there anything we can do for you?
Mm-hmm.
You know, like utilizing a tool, like loitering with the intent to commit prostitution, mm-hmm. utilizing that tool to detain you, but detain you in order to talk to you further about why you're actually out there.
Mm-hmm.
Do you think you would have talked to law enforcement at that point?
Yeah. Yeah. They weren't judging me or like, you know, I was just another hooker or another prostitute, like piece of trash, you know, like I would have felt like that they were at least a little bit concerned about my safety or whatnot, you know, so yeah, for sure. Like, yeah. Yeah, definitely.
At any point in time through the trauma with the trafficking to, you know, being homeless with the addiction, have you ever thought about, you know, harming yourself? Committing suicide or anything?
Yes, there was one time. and it was when I was homeless. And it was just like everything up to this point, the stuff that I was even dealing with while being homeless, on the streets, like, that's a dangerous place to be. And just being like a normal citizen or whatever, driving down the street and you see a homeless person, like, before I became homeless, like, I had no idea, like, what really goes on behind the scenes out there. Like, it's some scary stuff that happens out there. And, there's some scary stuff that happens out there. There's some evil people. It's just stuff that people would do to me out there, and I finally had enough of everything. And I like barricaded myself in one of my spots that I had at the time. I put a chain around the door and everything and barricaded myself inside while there was people outside of my place threatening me and just telling me, like, when I came out, like, what they would do to me. And it was just like, I had enough. Enough was enough, you know? Like, why? Like, why do people, like, why do I have to be hurt constantly, you know? I'm a good person and I have a big heart. And even when I was homeless, like, I would always put other people before me and try to help others, and even like the elderly ones out there, like, I was always trying to do stuff to help other people. And it's like, people are constantly taking advantage of that, like, my heart. And so, like, to continually want to be hurt, like, I was over it, you know? And it was just like, you know, so then I set everything on fire, and I was like, I'm over it. Like, I don't even want to be here anymore, you know? Like, what is the point? And so then just, like, everything started catching on fire. And, you know, and that's kind of like, I don't know if that was just like, I literally, like, I heard God just say to me, like, baby girl, like, you're loved. You know what I mean? You're loved. And that's all, like, I heard him say to me loud and clear, like, you are loved. And that's when it, like, clicked in my head, and, like, flashes of my kids and my family and my mom and just, like, everybody, like, flashes of all of them in my mind. And it's just like, no, like, this is not okay. And I ended up getting out somehow. I don't know how I got out, but I got out. And still, the people outside were still wanting to harm me, even after my whole place went up in flames. Like, they still wanted to hurt me. And I ended up having to run down Folsom Boulevard away from these people. They're chasing me down Folsom Boulevard. And it's like, I don't understand why. Like, you just literally saw me try to kill myself, and still, yeah, you want to hurt me, you know? So that was the one time that I thought about actually killing myself and actually trying to do it. You know, I was thinking about my kids and how they were growing up and everything. And, like, you know, I just told myself, like, I want to be there before they turned teenagers, you know? Like, I want to be there before they start junior high, or high school at least, you know? Like, I don't know what exactly it was that, like, was like, enough is enough, but I just know that I just couldn't deal with it anymore. I was like, I'm either going to die out here, or I'm going to end up in prison for the rest of my life. So the last day that I got arrested, you actually arrested me, because I had a little spot, you know, on some property that I had been arrested for before, for trespassing, but I went back there again. I don't even think you knew, or the other officers knew, that I was in there, but I did come out, because I was just over it. So I kind of just came out, like, you know. Yes, please just take me to jail, you know, like, so that was it for me, you know. I was just over it. I was tired. And then once I got to jail and I called my mom, which I would do every time, you know, that's when she told me, you know, my grandma wasn't doing so well, and, you know, she didn't have very much time left. So looking back on all of it, it's like, you know, I know there's a reason for everything, you know. God doesn't put you through certain things for no reason. And looking back, this kind of all, like, lined up. And my grandma, finding out about my grandma being sick when I did, hit me pretty hard, because if I had not gone to jail that day, I wouldn't have any idea what was going on with her. And I wouldn't have got to talk to her on the phone. I wouldn't have got to say goodbye. I wouldn't have got to give her the peace to leave this earth with, knowing that I was okay and that I was safe. You know, besides wanting this for myself, like, my grandma is the main thing, like, my main rock that holds me together, to stay clean and stay sober, and to, you know, just continue to keep working on myself and to better my life for me and my girls. So I do have a full-time job. I've been there for 2.5 years. I got bumped up to crew trainer within the first year, and now I'm like the crew like the team lead. Oh, and I bought my first car ever. I'm 37 years old and I bought my first car. You know, I make my payments on it every month and, you know, I'm just working on trying to get, you know, my own place now for me and my daughters.
And you have your kids back.
Yes, yes, I have my girls back. And that is just the reconciliation between me and my girls is definitely a God thing because I've put them through so much. I was in and out a lot with them. My youngest, I didn't even really get to raise her. She's 12 now. My mom has had her since she was a newborn. That's how often I was in and out of their lives. The reconciliation between me and them, from the moment I came home, it was like, I thought I was gonna have to deal with a lot of anger and resentment and hatred and just everything from them towards me, which I definitely would have deserved. But it's like, I was never gone. Like the relationship that I have with them is just like, they're literally like my best friends. I couldn't be more grateful for the way that they just welcomed me back home with just their arms just wide open, you know, like they were so excited and happy to see me walk through that door. And we've just been really tight ever since, you know, we've just been really close and they really are my best friends, you know, like I don't have friends. You know, I have like social media friends or, you know, stuff like that, but like people outside, like, you know, because I've been hurt by friends too, you know, and I've been manipulated and tricked and, you know, by girls that are supposed to be my friends. So I don't know if it's a protection thing for myself, but I'd just rather not. Like, I'm good with my kids, you know, and my family, you know. Like I said before, I try to find reason in everything. And, you know, when I was out there, and I was going through everything, you know, I would be angry with God and I would ask him why, like, why me? Like, why me, you know? And like, what's the point? Like, I literally sit there and scream at the sky, like, why? Like, what is the point of all of this, you know? But like, now that I've been through it and I've survived it and I've experienced it, I know there's a reason why he put me through all of that and that I've survived is so that I can help other people. And I can inspire other people to like give them hope and everything like that. Like, if I can survive it, like, you definitely can. And that's definitely been put on my heart to just be able to help in any way that I can by sharing my story. It's just a passion that I've had since getting clean and sober is to help in any way that I can. Not only is there a lot of evil people out there, there's a lot of good people still out there.